After just coming out of the Easter season, where we had all those beautiful Sundays of Easter, and then we had Easter itself and celebrated the resurrection, then the next thing we know, Pentecost was here, and then we had the Feast of the Holy Trinity, then Corpus Christi, your feast day, and now we have the 11th Sunday in ordinary time. Doesn't sound too much to capture the imagination. And I think it's because it has to do somewhat with our understanding of ordinary. You know, things can get so ho-hum. Ordinary really means something closer to another word that we have, regular. Regular time. Not Eastern Standard, not Daylight Savings, but regular time. This is where we practice, therefore, what we learn through the feasts and celebrations of our faith, through our tradition, through the Holy Scriptures in our life. And this is our regular work, to try to follow the Lord. Now look at our first reading today and our gospel. We're working here with people who have difficulty following the Lord. Now, don't you women get a little upset that right away in the gospel today, the Pharisee said, if he only knew what a sinner she was, this sinful woman. Well, I bet you she wasn't the only sinful woman, and besides that, not the only sinful person. Wouldn't you guess that to be true? Okay. But see how the judgment, the haughtiness, comes in. We have something going on here too, in a similar way, but a little bit more blinded in our first reading from the second book of Samuel. The first book of Samuel, if you remember, is about how the Lord was about finding a king and having the nation become a true kingdom with a king, and so Saul was the first king. But then it switches. It ends with the young little shepherd boy, David, from the house of Jesse, when Samuel went to go and look, and it was the little one, the youngest one, that was chosen, and he was whisked off to Jerusalem for king training. And Saul was very jealous of him once he found out that God had selected David to be the king. So our reading today, we hear about Nathan the prophet. Now, when we hear the prophet and the announcement of their words, we know that it's going to be some kind of declaration of God's judgment and a call to reform, renew, repent. But let's hear a little bit about David a little bit before. David, as I said, was in king training, right? And now, as we read in 2 Samuel, one day, instead of going out to be with his troops, it was the first part of spring, you see, and this is when they were about, what, conquering other places to what? Expand the kingdom, to add more territory, more people, more taxes. But David didn't go. Rather, in this palace, and it had to be huge with all the wives and concubines, etc., and the children, oh my goodness, you know. He was walking around the top, looking, maybe celebrating his kingdom. But then he looks, in true form to being a real man, he notices Bathsheba. She was taking a bath. I don't take a bath or shower with clothes on, do you? Need I say more? He grew attracted to her. And he summoned her to come. And she came. I mean, the king called. What are you going to do? She didn't know what it was about. And they had a very intimate relationship together. So much so, she became pregnant. Now King David is really in trouble because this was frowned upon. You know, the commandments of God were even on the king. No one could get away from the rules of God. And adultery, well, it just wasn't accepted. And so they stoned people back then. They killed them. So David, in his brilliance and his intelligence, as he was listening to a little voice in his shoulder called the devil, said, call her husband in, Uriah the Hittite. We heard his name in the reading today. And do you know what Uriah did? He was like one of the big generals we would liken him today, out on the field, and all the troops and all the flanks and all the military would look to his lead because he was the field marshal. So David said, let me call Uriah back home for a little unexpected vacation so that maybe he could spend some time with his wife. Do I have to say anything more? Problem solved, thought David. But ha-ha. Uriah comes before King David and kind of is wondering, why are you so kind to me, allowing me to come on this furlough, on this extension? You know, why, when my troops are out there, I have to hurry and get back to them. I'm worried about them. You know, I'm responsible in my position, and I do what I can to protect these, your military, for you, King. And David says, well, why don't you just stay over the night, at least one night or two, then you can go back. And Uriah kept saying, no, I have to go. I have to go and be with these who defend us, who are putting their lives at stake for what we have in guard and for our expansion. David tried to get Uriah to stay. And so David said, how about let's have a drink? And after one bottle was done, another was opened, David said, I'll get him drunk. Then I'll have him taken to his house. And this will get to be with Bathsheba, his wife, and no one will be the wiser. Uriah still wouldn't go. He had someone take him back to the field. So David's thinking feverishly here, what do I do? What do I do? What do I do? Oh my God. You know what it's like when you're in trouble and you think somebody's going to find out, or when you committed a sin. You know, just like Adam and Eve, what did they do? They ran and hid from God. Adam, Eve, I know where you are. Come here. We tend to hide. Even little pets. We have a little dog, my sister and I, and her name's Chaley. She's a mix of a poodle and a shih tzu. And if you go into the room and see what she's done to the toilet paper, this was especially when she was a puppy, all you had to do is say, Chaley, what are you doing? Gone. She knew what was coming next, a reprimand. And we learned that as children as well, right? Uh-oh, here it is. David thought of this scheme. He wrote a letter. Dear Joab, who was the supreme commander of the forces, have Uriah lead the troops out to the battlefield. Have Uriah take a very large lead in front of them. And when Uriah can no longer hear or see them, have all the troops retreat. In the middle of enemy territory, Uriah was the only one for the defending people to kill. He was dead. King David was a murderer, not just an adulterer. So news got back to David and then Bathsheba, and he could carry on. And he thought, but Nathan comes, the prophet, today, and says, Nathan says to David, excuse me, you know what? I'm going to tell you a story. And he told him this little parable. In fact, the first reading and the gospel both have parables, teaching stories. And he said that there was this rich man who wanted to have a feast. He had lots of lamb in his flock, tons. But he saw this poor person with a very beautiful lamb, and he took it from him. And this is what he had his party with. And David said, well, that's terrible. How dare someone? He said, you did this very same thing with Uriah. And you think God didn't know, but God knows what you did. He knows the evil designs of your heart. And as these words were coming to him, piercing David, David said, oh my Lord. He's coming to his senses. He begins to see his selfishness, his pride, all of that. Lord, forgive me. And Nathan says, the Lord does forgive you, David, but the sword will never leave your family. In other words, there's going to be a lot of fighting, a lot of struggle, a lot of upset. In the parable that we hear in the gospel, we hear about people that owe debts. One lots, one lesser. He forgives them both. And which one's going to love? The one with the larger debt, of course. It's more money, more stuff. And Jesus is trying to illustrate what this woman is doing. She was atoning, repenting, desiring penance from the author of life himself, the only begotten Son of God. She had it right. This sinful woman had it right. David eventually gets it and gets it right. And now it's for us. Do we get it right? You know, I'm a pretty outgoing person. And somebody says, you know, as I cover and help out all over the place, the shrine, the basilica, other parishes, don't you ever get afraid standing up there? And I said, no. I'm not judging you, but we're in good company with one another because we are sinners. We've all broken God's law in one way or another. Who among us has not said, oh, this is the only time and God will allow me to do it just this once? Or, I forgot. Or we make it easier for ourselves. Like we're the one that gives the law, right? God's given the rules for us to live by. And St. Paul today makes some interesting point. If everything was just following laws, then Jesus came for nothing. And there's truth to that. But we need guidelines, regulation, rules, commandments, if you will, to know what is the Lord's will, what to stay away from, and then to choose the way of the Lord, to know our sins. One of the problems facing the church today, and this is kind of universal, is that individuals have set themselves up to be their own legislators of what is sin and not sin, what counts, what doesn't. Subjectivism. Because I, the subject, say this isn't bad for me, even though God says differently. Wrong orientation. We are supposed to be objective, above ourselves, and handed down to us through our faith tradition from Judeo times, with Moses' Ten Commandments, unto Jesus' Beatitudes and two great commandments. We have guidelines to live by. The church has rules. Every club has rules. Every organization has guidelines for their membership. And we belong to that Roman Catholic Church. And so we have rules to follow because we belong to the Roman Catholic Church. We have laws and commandments to follow because we are Christian. We follow the way of Christ as revealed, Word of God, to shape us morally. See, David was caught up in, I can get away from this through human rationalization. And you can't. You cannot. We can do that. Just doesn't come clean when you're standing before the throne of God. They said, oh, yeah, now about this one little episode over here, and what about this, and what about that? What do you have to say for yourself now? Brothers and sisters, the point is, there is sin in the world. But But very importantly, through Jesus Christ, there is God's love and mercy. Our psalm response is, the Lord is near to all who call upon him. Yes, the Lord does hear us. Yes, the Lord does forgive us. Yes, the Lord blesses us in his mercy. It's true, but don't think he doesn't love you because it isn't your way or the way you wanted it to be. It doesn't go that way. I remember once, you know, as a kid, I wanted a bicycle for my birthday, which is in August. And I asked and I prayed and I did everything I learned in Catholic school what to do. And my birthday came, no bike. Well, the next big time coming up would be way in December for Christmas. So about the middle of December, I ran to our living room where there was a big statue of Our Lady. And I ran to my closet in my bedroom, put stuff all over it, and I wrote a letter to God. Dear God, if you ever want to see your mother again, you see, it doesn't work, did it? But I got the bike anyway. You see, we can't barter and reduce it for us. We can't do this kind of playing. We are called to be mature and growing in maturity of our faith in Christ, who suffered and died for us. We just not long ago celebrated all that in the Triduum, the three great days. But every Mass we come and recall the stories that help and are meant to move us so we can be about doing regularly, in regular time, the regular deeds of those who follow the Christ. So this is regular time, ordinary time if you insist, but this is where we put into practice all that we celebrated, all that has been given to us. And it always comes down, God is a God of love, a forgiving, healing God, and wants his children to be near him all the time. He's with us even when we sin. He loved David so much. He had big hopes for David, that David would be the one to help the world be ready for this forgiveness, but David failed. Everyone God was picking failed. Moses, Noah, Abraham, Adam and Eve, the kings, the judges, nobody was getting it. So he had to send his son to tell us the heart, not the law, of God. And that is pure love. I was saying that if we really realized how much God loved us, we would die of delight, of pleasure. We can't contain that much joy and that much love. And that's what Jesus extended his hands on the cross for and died for those sins, washes us clean with the blood that came from his sacred body, but rose on Easter Sunday to say, hey, you can die to the bad stuff and you'll rise with God. And that's where God wants you. He wants you to be walking with him in hope. So brothers and sisters, let's keep doing the regular thing. Keep trying. Keep trying to avoid sin. Keep trying to follow the Lord. Ask for his grace and know that he loves you and will help you every step of the way. And he will bless you for your attempts of trying to know what pleases him and to do it. The lady's sins were forgiven. King David's sin was forgiven. And our sins have been forgiven on the cross. And mercy is available to you and the embrace of God's love for an eternity. Let's do the regular thing and get in line for our procession to heaven.